producers are mergers where producers of similar goods, they are catering to the same set of customers, they merge. So imagine that the two cell phone companies, they are essentially catering to the similar customer base, and then they are competing in the market to can all of you mute it right now, because I'm getting some noise from. Okay, please mute everything. Okay, so essentially that kind of mergers are known as horizontal mergers. So essentially the rival firms, they merge in order to some kind of take some advantage in the market competition. Okay, so maybe if they merge, they become a new entity, and after that new entity, so given that there is no competition, so there is not much loss from the competitive dissipation of the rent and profit, so they prefer to merge. So these are known as horizontal mergers. Now if you go through any standard textbook or like OSCI or other kind of thing, you will find that people do consider different other types of mergers, and they have different terminology for those things. So those things are not of much relevance for the type of modeling that we will be considering. So somewhere or the other, those mergers, like there is a term called conglomerate merger and other kind of things. So you can look through the definition, but essentially the idea is that either you are vertically merging, that is with your some preliminary kind of earlier production chain, some supplier, or you are merging with your competitor or rivals in the same market. Okay, so these are two types of merger. Now in the merger literature, the first and foremost, which is in vain with the kind of models we will be doing, is by Salant, Switzer and Reynolds. These are the three authors, in most probably in QJ 1983. So they have found out something very puzzling, but if you look through the example, you will find that it's not at all puzzling. So that they found out that if you consider that there is Kurna competition, Kurna oligopolistic competition, then between the rivals, there is very little incentive to merge. And his point was that you think of the number of firms, and then you think of the gain from merger. Now, as soon as the two firms or three firms or five firms merge, they become a single entity. And because of the Kurnow conjecture, the way they choose output in competition with other firms in the market who are outside the merger process, so then that creates a kind of disadvantage for the merged entity. Okay, because now they are choosing only one quantity for the entire merge unit, entity, and as a result, they become a single player as compared to those who remain outside the merger process. They remain as they were earlier. So imagine that you have situations like 10 firms and two of them are trying to merge. Then as soon as two of them merge, then the market becomes a Kurnow oligopoly with 9 firms. Okay. But in that case, the 9th firm, which is the creation of 9 and 10 merged into a single entity, and say call it say the 9th firm, that particular firm will be competing with another 8 firms. So as a result, when it chooses the Kurnow quantity, the Kurnow equilibrium, Nash equilibrium, will be essentially that as if there are 9 firms, and this merged entity, which is now the merger of 9 and 10, will be actually getting the profit of that 9th firm. So this particular profit, when you have 10 firms and only 2 are merging, you never find that a profitable merger. Okay, so that's where the puzzle lies. Okay, so if you take a simple linear demand function and then a constant marginal cost for all the firms, then you know that your profit will be typically A minus C whole square by N plus 1 square, I believe. Yes, N plus 1 square. So for example, in the duopoly case, your profits are A minus C whole square by 9. Okay. Similarly, if you have n farm, your profit will be each of the farm will be earning profit a minus c whole square by n plus n whole square. Okay, so under this situation, merging from duopoly to monopoly, you can see it is profitable because monopoly profit is a minus c whole square by 4, and the two duopoly profit taken together will be a minus c whole square by 9 into 2. So that particular profit will certainly be lower than the a minus c whole square by 4. Okay, so if you have only two farms merging into one and becoming a monopoly is profitable. What happens if you have three farms? Now in the three farms case, if you look at your Purno profits now, your each of the farms are getting a minus c whole square by 16. Okay, now if out of the three farms two of them merge, so then that two farms will be getting under the new situation under duopoly a minus c whole square by 9, whereas if they remain separated, then they will be getting a minus c whole square by 16 each, so 2 into this. Okay, so now you can easily check which side is greater. So will the duopoly profit of the these two merged entity is greater, or the other side is greater, that is 2 into a minus c whole square by 16 is greater. You will certainly see that remaining separated is a better option. Okay, clear? Because 2 by 16 is 1 by 8, so 1 by 8 is greater than 1 by 9, so remaining two separated and enjoying their the duopoly profit each of them are getting under that three farms case, that is a better outcome than merging into two farms and then competing with the outside farms, which is one, so that becomes a duopoly situation, so that is not a profitable merger. Okay, then if you continue doing that, then if you have five farms, then four of them merging will be profitable. Okay, so if you continue like that, you will be always able to find out that how many farms are critical for this merger to be profitable. So, and in the kind of as a matter of observation, if at least 80% of the farms engage in the merger, then that merger is profitable, otherwise not. Okay, so you can continue increasing the number, and then you will find 80% of the farms in the market are merging. Then under Kuhn competition, merger will be profitable. But that seems sitting at odds with the empirical observation where we do find that farms are generally merging. So there are lots of bilateral merger despite there are many players in the market. Okay, so that means you need to find out the other advantages of merger, and the literature has gone into some kind of developing those ideas that what are the other reasons could be for merging. Because if you remain in the Kuhn competition assumption and standard constant marginal cost for everyone, then you will typically find that margin of 80% will be profitable but no less. So that means that there should have been very little margin. Okay, so then different authors have tried to go into the details. So Kamian and Jung is another interesting paper which has looked into the endogenous process of acquisition with the linear demand concentrations to scale. They showed that there is no merger in equilibrium with more than two initial farms. Okay, that's again a negative result, similar to the Saran, Switzer, Reynolds. Okay, so this is the Kuhn competition related puzzle, that it is not easy to justify merger under Kuhn competition if we maintain the standard Kuhn assumption that new entity will be becoming one player and will be choosing quantity in competition with others. Okay, so that's it. So now you have to find out different kinds of other situations where merger can still be profitable. One possible way is known as synergy. So maybe two firms are merging, but when their capital assets are also merged, their capability goes up, and given that these merged entities capability goes up, it is possible that they enjoy some kind of cost advantage. So this cost advantage is known as synergistic benefit when the two entities merge, and that merging and the synergy benefit might sometime help them to merge what is not predicted by the Salland-Switzer-Enrol kind of story. Okay, and also Denecker and Davidson talked about the price competition, that Uno competition is quantity, but if you have price competition, so then there would be more incentive for merging. Okay, so in particular, some authors have shown that the profitability of merger is enhanced by assuming, for instance, that firms compete in prices. Okay, so if the merger takes place, the price competition is typically very severe competition, so that competition gets softened, and as a result, it becomes more profitable to merge under price competition than under quantity competition. So that was kind of finding of Denecker and Davidson. Okay, and part of this synergy type of story is also elaborated by Perry and Porter. It says that capital stock that the merged entity enjoys now might affect the marginal cost, so that will also improve the efficiency of the merger. Okay, so there are other papers also. This is some IGIO paper which also considered merger, but they have looked at the what happens to the merger incentive if we have delegation possibility similar to the Fastman and Judd, where the firm owners are delegating the output decisions to the manager. And as soon as they do so, you know that after delegation, the market becomes more competitive. So because of that reason, what you essentially get that this competition gets little softened. So if they merge, so given that without the merger, delegation leads to harsher competition, so it is better to there is more incentive for merger if the firms are all delegated firms or similar to the Fastman Judd kind of story. Okay, so this is another paper which and this delegation story, if you want to compare with the Denecker Davidson, it's a similar, because price competition is typically harsher. Similarly, delegation also leads to tougher competitions because of this. The incentives are on the sales, so the more quantities are produced by both the managers, and that leads to harsher competitions, and as a result, you get more incentive for merger under delegation. So okay, so these are different variations that are considered in the literature. Then also, this is also another classic paper, bilateral monopolies and incentives for mergers. So here basically what they are considering, similar to some of the models we have considered. So you have upstream, downstream, and upstream, downstream are kind of related because of their input supply. And then they looked at that how the bargaining between the upstream and downstream firm essentially affects the merger incentive of the downstream firms. Okay, so this is another very good paper. This is a Rand Journal paper, and that has talked in, looked into that what happens if you have bargaining between the input seller and the output final good producer. Then in order to take advantage with respect to those bargaining, maybe the final good producers would like to merge, okay, because then these input sellers will be at disadvantage because there is a single entity. So basically the monopoly power that will be generated in the downstream firm will exercise some power to extract some more rent from the bargaining with the input sellers, and because of that mergers will be more profitable when you have the bargaining story embedded. So the bargaining power gets affected by merger. So that's another kind of story which is also done in the literature. And there is another paper by Farrell and Shapiro. This is a year paper, and you can look through all of them. Okay, so now I will share another screen. This here we'll be looking at international merger, because our interest is to analyze. Could you please mute? Okay, so this is this particular idea is related to two of my earlier work. and they are published, but this is what you are finding here is basically a synopsis of those two papers. If you are interested in the original paper, one of them is 2008 JEBO, Journal of Economic Behavior and Organization, and that's the adverse selection story that we will be focusing on in the initial model. And the second model will be another asymmetric information, but that is about the informed principle. So those story can also be finally extended in terms of signaling, but I didn't extend that. I have simply looked through that if you have informed principle, how the merger issue gets shaped. So that paper is Journal of Development Economics paper 2001. So if you are interested to go through the original papers, you can look through my webpage and find out those two references and download them. Okay. But what material I have supplied is essentially some synopsis of those two models in a coherent framework. Okay. So what's the idea we are trying to do? Now, as I told you that we know typically two kinds of merger, horizontal and vertical, but merger can also take place across country. So one firm from one country might merge with another firm from another country, okay? Maybe to produce and supply in third country, or maybe to produce and supply in a particular host country where there is a host firm already functioning and there is a foreign firm which is trying to enter. And when the foreign firm is trying to enter, it has the option of either a direct entry, that option is typically known as foreign direct investment, okay? Or sometimes, again, if you go to the management literature of these issues, there are plenty of jargons they use. So they also call it greenfield investment, okay? And also when they acquired in the domestic firm, they also call it brownfield investment. But those terminologies are, in my view, are not essential for the kind of stuff that we do in the course, okay? But the idea is that there is, for a foreign firm, there are two distinct option. One is they can directly enter into the host country and supply, and plenty of foreign firms came into India after the 1991 liberalization, and many of you might have been just not 1 year old at that time, and then start operation in India. Another possibility was that they can simply acquire some Indian company and bring in all the necessary capital, the machinery, new technology, everything, and revamp that existing Indian firm, which may not be at the technology frontier in terms of its capability and efficiency. It can improve that particular firm and then essentially produce for India. Okay, so I am looking at that kind of situation of liberalization where foreign firm is entering into the country either through foreign direct investment, okay, that means setting up of its own business, and that is known as subsidiary, okay, for the foreign firm, or they are simply forming a merger with their domestic firm, and as a result of that merger, the domestic firm no longer exists and foreign firm acquires all the relevant assets, lands and everything, and start produce, use their machinery if they are in good condition or they are in compatible degree with the kind of technology that the foreign firm uses. So then they start operation from there. Okay, so this is the idea I'll be trying to explore. But what is the interesting dimension of this story? Interesting dimension is that when in a country like India, when the liberalization took place, if you look at the history of liberalization, you will find that it has been gradual. So that was the focus of my two papers that are published, that there is gradual liberalization, which means that initially the foreign firms were not fully allowed in terms of 100% subsidy operations. And being today's generation, you know, only recently in the defense sectors, even some of the production activities are now 100% FDI oriented. So the government has allowed 100% FDI investment in some of the, even the defense like strategic sectors. But earlier in those days, in 90s, even for automobile also, you have to come to some domestic domestic partner because you are not allowed to hold, say, maybe 49% being a foreigner. Okay, so those were the days in at that time these models were written in 90s or towards the end of 90s. And what I am focusing on essentially not this gradual liberalization process, simply a process that you want to acquire some asset of another company. How do you acquire? Okay, now when you acquire the assets of another company where you have a potential competitor already operating and you have that option of direct entry, okay, from the foreign company's perspective, or you can acquire some shares of this company, and then that is, in my definition, is merger. So you can acquire some shares of the company that is already operating in India. When you are acquiring the shares, you are acquiring in bulk. So you have the necessary managerial say and everything in the corporate governance. So you can bring in your technology, your efficiency, and try to maximize the profit in this new entity where you hold shares. Okay, so that governance issue is slightly kept aside, but simply that if you merge, then you own shares, and depending on the profit that is earned, you will be getting the profit as per that share distribution. Okay, but rest of the other complications, like what kind of governance is there inside the firm, who controls, like the Grossman-Hart situations, we are not venturing into those aspects right now in these two models that we'll be considering. Okay, so there are some literature that is talked about, and if you look at the large number of international mergers took place in 80s and 90s, so there was merger wave in the international, in the global scenario. Okay, so not only for India, the plenty of emerging market economies which were erstwhile either under Soviet influence or under state command in a big way, they started liberalizing their economies in 80s and 90s. So it was observed internationally and UNCTAD reported there's a bulk of those foreign investments, they actually took the form of international mergers where the foreign firms went into a domestic country and acquired some domestic partner for their operation. Okay, so these are a couple of references. So this Q and Zhao, not Q, this is Chu and Zhao. This is a Chinese pronunciation, Hong Kong based guy. Okay, under asymmetric information about local market, information sharing enhances the profitability of a merger between domestic and foreign firm. So this is also about an asymmetric information story, 2004, most probably in Journal of Development Economics or Journal of International Economics, one of them. You can check from the reference list. Okay, so this is one aspect which talks about that under asymmetric information, sharing information is helpful. Okay, Das and Sengupta has another paper with private information, and they typically conclude that asymmetric information might cause a hindrance to merger. Okay, so they also have an asymmetric information story around the same time developed. Okay, so we will be looking at two different scenarios. Simply put, when a foreign firm is entering a country like India, they do not know the exact demand function of Indian market. Okay, so in other words, there is plenty of reservations about whether there will be potentially enough demand in Indian market to justify XYZ decisions of the foreign firm. Because this is the time we are looking at that there's a gradual liberalization and many of the products were not existing in that big way. So there is not enough market assessment about what would the demand tomorrow. So when the foreign firm comes in, the price they pay for the shares of the host firm, they are not sure what would that those piece of share will yield after the after 1 year or 5 years or whatever. Okay, so in a sense, what would be the value of those shares that they are buying from the domestic partner after some time? So they are not sure about that. Main reason is that there is not enough knowledge for the foreign firm about the exact demand function that exists in India. Whereas the idea is that for the domestic firm, although they may have many difficulties in terms of technology and others, they might have better information about the domestic demand. So in other words, they are the domestic firms. They have been working in this market for quite some time. They have reasonable knowledge, database about their customers and all. They know whether a particular variant of the car will be sold in the market and all that. So essentially, they have the proper estimate about what kind of demand function the market will have. Okay, but foreign firm will not know. So we are considering the asymmetric information where domestic firm will know the demand, but foreign firm will not know the demand. We also consider another dimension of the problem, which will be our second model, that foreign firm has private information regarding its own cost of production. So essentially, the technology that foreign firm will bring in, that technology and its efficiency will only be known to the owner of that technology, that is the foreign firm. And host firm will have apprehension that, okay, I am coming to an arrangement with this foreign firm for this kind of technology collaboration by kind of conceding some of my shares to this foreign firm. But what does it really worth? Because I do not know exactly the capability of this foreign firm in terms of revamping the my production activities to increase the profit in the market. Okay, so one is a demand story, asymmetric information about demand. Another is a cost story, which is asymmetric information about cost. So these are the two models that we will be looking into.
Sir, hello. Hello.
Yeah, tell me.
So the two scenarios can be happening at the same time also, right?
Yeah, but that would be very complicated in analyzing, okay? So that's why that's whenever you write something, you need to make thousands of simplifying assumptions to make your model or theory or whatever you are trying to do tractable, if it is in theory, okay? Had it been an empirical thing, then you could have taken as one of the kind of variable on your right hand side. Okay, but that's not possible under theory. So when you have double-sided asymmetric information, the analysis will be tedious and difficult. Okay, so to highlight some of the interesting feature of a particular distortion, it is always better to take one at a time rather than taking everything together. Then we will miss out the essential features of how much demand asymmetry is creating a role, how much cost asymmetry is creating a role. Okay, is that clear?
Yes, sir.
So the mathematics will be tedious and complicated, and you will lose. There are plenty of literature where people have tried to, not in the merger context, but try to analyze in the principal agent setup this kind of double-sided asymmetric information. Okay, but those models are typically very difficult algebraically as well as conceptually. Okay. So we will be looking at one at a time, one model with demand, another model with cost. Clear?
Yes, sir.
Completeness in the contract, okay? So that would be our punchline that maybe due to the incomplete contracting, this particular asymmetric information might come on the way of forming merger, and as a result, merger may not take place. Okay. So that's one. And secondly, incomplete contract is one, and another. The second model will highlight that high entry cost may complicate the merger process and merger may not be formed for some parameter values. Okay, so these two are the two essential ingredient that will be highlighted for the final outcome that we'll be analyzing. So we'll be analyzing only two firms, both with the same marginal cost. Both firms are risk neutral, so we will be working with the expected payoff calculation. The foreign firm, so now we are considering the following game, where the game will be foreign firm as in a, we are considering a principal agent setup where foreign firm will be extracting interest surplus from the relationship. So it will essentially make an offer of acquiring some shares at some price. So S is the the share that the foreign firm wants to acquire from the domestic company is a fraction out of 100 or out of 1. I will be considering total share as 1. So S will be a fraction of that share, okay? And P is the price that the foreign company is paying to the domestic company to buy that S shares, okay? And then host firm, the domestic firm can either accept or reject the offer, okay? So there is an offer to buy me out by some foreign firm, but then it's my decision whether to accept that offer or not. And then foreign firm decides whether to enter directly or not. So this is, this third stage is an important stage to understand, that even after acceptance of the or rejection of the contract, this option of direct entry is still available with the foreign firm. Okay. Now we will be considering two variants of this. So one is that stage three model, stage three game can be pre-committed. So in a sense that the foreign firm can pre-commit to the domestic firm that if you accept the contract offer, then I'm not going to enter. Another possibility is that in the sub game, even after acceptance, the foreign firm can still decide, and there is no rule law which prevents the foreign firm from further entry. So suppose I formed a joint venture with you, or I have bought some shares in your company, but still I can float my another company in the same product market. Okay. So that's allowed by the government rules because it improves the competition in the market. So government will not typically prevent such kind of behavior. And in Indian context, this was allowed in the 90s towards the end, that many companies, domestic companies, tries to follow the legal route to prevent such things. Referring to some contract clause that this was a one-time arrangement and this was a lifetime arrangement. They should not have come in another with another venture, either by on their own or with any other party. So that was part of the clause agreed upon at the time of this kind of merger formation. Now they are doing it again, so that should be prevented. But in those cases were typically not considered. Can you? Yes. Hello. Can you view the screen?
Yes.
Okay, fine.
Yes, sir.
Okay, okay. Yes, sir. Thank you. So the when I ask, say, if a couple of people take responsibility of responding, that would be helpful. Not everyone needs to unmute, so that then everybody knows it's a free rider problem. Everybody is thinking that the somebody else will respond. Okay, so now the stage three problem will be differentiating into two parts. First model will be that where it can actually commit not to enter. Okay, now if that happens, then we will have certain outcome, and then we will see what happens if that kind of commitment is not possible. So today I am coming into some kind of merger with you, but I'm keeping my options open for the future, okay? And that keeping that option open also mean that you being my partner of this merger will anticipate that behavior from me, that tomorrow I will actually go on my own in terms of floating a new company in your own backyard. So if that possibility is there, so when you are agreeing to this S and P, you will factor in that behavior of mine in the future, and that will complicate the analysis, okay? So that would be our point that will highlight that because of that particular commitment issue, that no contract is possible in terms of future entry by the foreign firm. So that incompleteness in the contract is creating the problem of merger under certain circumstances, and that will be showing. So we'll be showing two different things. One, if commitment is possible, we'll show that it is a smooth process. Even with asymmetric information, it is possible to merge by the two parties. But if that kind of commitment is not possible, then in the presence of... So I'm back again. Okay, thank you. So now, do you have any question? Do you have any question right now? Otherwise, I will start proceeding.
No, sir, you can continue.
Okay, that's fantastic. So now I will have few more assumptions before I proceed. So these are, if you remember, the foreign firms enters if it gets strictly greater payoff than the no entry option. So these are assumptions like tie breaking assumption. Whenever they are indifferent, we take certain assumptions. Whenever they are strictly preferring something, they do something. So that is how we do in the principal agent literature, depending on our convenience. Okay. So if you look at these first two bullet points, the host firm accepts the buyout offer when it receives weekly greater payoff than rejection. So which means we are assuming here that acceptance will occur whenever the host firm is indifferent between the two payoffs. Between that acceptance and rejections, two options after the SNP offer. So whenever it is indifferent, host firm will accept. That's our assumption. See, but in the case of entry, we are assuming that the foreign firm does not unnecessarily enter when it is indifferent. It will enter only if there is strictly greater payoff. Okay, so that is one assumption we are making. Okay, just for our convenience to have a nice closed model. Now, if it enters, it has to incur a setup cost, which is F, which is greater than zero. Now, total duopoly profit is less than the monopoly profit. Now, this is the assumption we are making under this particular assumption holds for simple linear demand and constant marginal cost. Okay. So essentially 2 into duopoly profit is lower than the monopoly profit, and market being monopolized is helpful for the two parties. But on the other hand, there are situations like if you take the increasing cost, like convex cost. So then you will find that maybe some situations will emerge where 2 into duopoly profit will be greater than the monopoly profit, provided that you assume that the monopoly will be running only one plant with that convex cost. Okay. So those are the kind of simple undergraduate stuff. But here our assumption is that to make merger or this acquisition somewhat with a force, then we are considering that it is better to have monopoly than duopoly, and the profit is higher. Okay. So now, first we consider a complete information version of the game. Now, imagine that SNP is the offer we are making. I do not have the game here drawn. No, I cannot draw right now. I don't have the tools in front of me. So essentially imagine that foreign firm draw a line. So that's the SNP offer, and the acceptance and rejection take place in two different directions. Okay. So that's our first story. And then after acceptance or rejection, the foreign firm can decide whether to enter or not. So that's how the binary choices are allocated to the two parties. MNC moves first. And with SNP, so that's a continuous choice. We are only drawing one line, and then you can have accept and reject to discrete choices. And then again, MNC can decide whether to enter or not after these two choices of the host firm. So in those first, second, third, and fourth nodes, there will be entry and no entry options drawn. Okay. So this is our game structure. Now, we consider that our lambda is the ratio of duopoly to monopoly profit. Okay. And we consider J is the monopoly profit. Now, if J is the monopoly profit, lambda J will be the duopoly profit. And we are assuming that the 2 into duopoly profit is lower than the monopoly profit. So our lambda is less than half. Okay. Now, we assume that entry is feasible. That means that lambda j minus f is greater than zero. Now, if this is not a feasible option, then obviously that entry option is out of the window. So that threat of entry cannot be used because that's a non-credible threat. So this greater than zero means that it is credible that MNC might enter in this particular country on his own. So that option is available to him. So in case of rejection, this option will be exercised by the MNC to get some positive profit. Okay. So, and if that happens, then host firm knows that there will be competition in duopoly and lambda j will be its own profit. So given that we are not assuming any asymmetric cost or anything, so both the firms will get lambda j profit, and MNC is making the entry, so it has this additional cost of entry, that is F. So lambda j minus F is MNC's payoff, and lambda j will be host firm's payoff in case the offer of buyout or acquisition S and P is rejected by the host firm. So host firm knows that. Host firm knows that this guy will enter, and as a result, if I reject the offer, I will get lambda j. Then if after rejection I get lambda j, then knowing that particular possibility, the MNC can simply give the offer that lambda j is obtained by host firm. And if lambda j is obtained by host firm, then host firm will be indifferent between acceptance of the offer and rejection of the offer. So host firm will essentially accept that offer. Okay. So one equilibrium that we can simply propose now is S and P are such that you are essentially asking that I will buy you out completely with 100% shares by paying you lambda j amount, because that's what you will be getting after rejection. Okay. So the host firm will be happy and exit the market with this lambda j payoff to him, and that would be a happy situation for MNC, and MNC will completely acquire this domestic firm. Okay, so that's one candidate for equilibrium. Now this will generate the MNC or the foreign firm this j minus lambda j amount of profit. Now remember, this is far greater than the lambda j minus F, which is it will get after direct entry. Okay, clear? So one equilibrium is obtained where there is complete buyout. Can there be more equilibrium? Yes, there can be many more equilibrium. And now imagine that the S and P are chosen in a manner that after the buyout, 1 minus alpha amount of share is bought out by the foreign firm. So S is equal to 1 minus alpha, which means that alpha portion of the total share is still remaining with the host firm. So which means that after this particular offer of S equal to 1 minus alpha, if it is accepted, if it is rejected by the host firm, then if it is accepted by the host firm, after that acceptance, if MNC tries to enter, what will be its payoff? Its payoff will be from the subsidiary operation lambda j minus f. And given that some agreement has already reached about the initial buyout, so there the share distribution is alpha for host firm and 1 minus alpha for MNC. So you will get 1 minus alpha lambda j. So this will be a total payoff if you enter even after the agreement, where the agreement involves a alpha share for host firm and 1 minus alpha share for foreign firm. Now this total payoff, if it is less than 1 minus alpha j, which means that if it does not enter, then the market will remain monopoly. So j will be the payoff, and MNC holding 1 minus alpha share will be getting 1 minus alpha. So if this particular payoff is greater than the left hand side, then it will not enter. Clear? Okay. So this expression can be simplified in terms of that holding of shares by the host firm alpha must be less than equal to a critical number. You can just simply follow the steps to get this. And that critical number is H. So in other words, if the host firm owns after the merging little share, that means major portion of the share is with the foreign firm, then foreign firm would not like to enter to compete with almost itself, because it is the major shareholder of the company and it is bringing in a new company. Two of them are competing, and when two of them are competing, we all know that competition leads to some competitive dissipation of rain. That is the assumption of that duopoly profit is lower than the monopoly profit. So even if these two entities, they are involved in duopoly competition, the total payoff that will be generated from the merged entity as well as the new entity that the foreign firm might like to set up as a subsidiary, the total profit is less. So it is not in the interest of the foreign firm if foreign firm actually owns a major portion of the shares. So in other words, if alpha equal to zero, that means after the complete buyout, the foreign firm will never enter, because if it enters, then it is actually creating a competition with itself, and that is becoming a duopoly situation, and that is a lower amount of profit for the foreign firm. So foreign firm would not do so. So if alpha equal to zero, similarly, if alpha is very close to zero, then also foreign firm will not do. So even if the merged entity has some positive shares of the host firm, then foreign firm will still not like to do it if the condition one is satisfied. Okay, if the condition one is not satisfied, then foreign firm will have incentive to enter into the market even after the acceptance of the offer. Then what are the other equilibrium? Now remember that alpha equal to zero is what we have actually analyzed, that complete buyout is a candidate for equilibrium, and we have seen that it is an equilibrium. Now if alpha belongs to zero and H between this critical zone, then you will see that foreign firm does not enter. So you have to buy out in a manner that your SJ, that means the amount of share you are trying to buy out, must leave the host firm with a share that is alpha, okay, lower than this H. Okay, so that you do not have any further incentive to enter. And what is the advantage of that? Advantage is you can avoid entry cost, that is F. Also the loss from the competition. So what would be the new kind of offer that I can think of? I can think of an offer that where SJ is such that 1 minus SJ is alpha. So alpha into J plus the amount of price that I pay to the host firm is such that is equal to the host firm's reservation payoff, because this is what it gets by simply rejecting any buyout offer of S&P. Okay, so this has to be satisfied, and so alpha J plus PJ should be equal to lambda J, and if I am able to design such an offer, then I will be getting as a foreign firm J minus lambda J. Okay, so our first proposition follows that the foreign firm makes a merger offer such that the host firm gets lambda J and the host firm accepts that offer. Foreign firm does not enter after the merger. Okay, so let me just explain a little bit on this. So lambda for linear demand is 4/9. Okay, so if you take the ratio of duopoly to monopoly profit, then you know that in a standard Kuhn equilibrium, you will have A minus C whole square by 9 as your duopoly and A minus C whole square by 4 as your monopoly profit, and the ratio of duopoly to monopoly profit is 4/9. Now this 4/9 is the lambda value. Now I have this H, so alpha should be below that H. So imagine that alpha is below that H and alpha is equal to 4/9. That means the host firm is actually holding a share which is 4/9 of the firm. Now if host firm is holding the 4/9 of the firm, then it will get 4/9 J, that is exactly the lambda J. Okay, so you do not need to pay anything to buy out your 5x9 amount of shares, simply by using the set of entry, you can actually expropriate that amount of shares and the host firm will agree, because host firm knows the subsequent equilibrium payoff that will follow in case it does not accept. Okay, so if alpha is equal to 4x9 and that 4x9 is still less than h, then you are done and you do not need to pay anything and you are able to do it. But there is no guarantee that this particular h will be less than, greater than 4x9. Suppose it is less than 4x9. What does that mean? That means alpha should be much lower. So suppose imagine alpha has to be 10%. Now if alpha is 10%, so 10% of the shares will be owned by the host firm. So it will get 10% of the monopoly profit. But what is its expected profit if it rejects? If it rejects, it gets 4x9 into monopoly profit. Here it is getting 10% of the monopoly profit. Okay. So this PJ has to be such that it is compensated in a manner that it does get 4x9J. Okay. So you can determine how much will be your PJ value when alpha has to be 10%. And we are thinking that that kind of low alpha will lead to it is below H. Okay. We can also have much lower alpha. Imagine that alpha is say 5%. In the same manner, there has to be PJ in such a manner that lambda J is guaranteed payoff for the host firm so that it accepts the contract. So this brings us to the proposition one, that under complete information, this merger is possible and host firm accepts that offer. Okay. And foreign firm never enters after the merger with a subsidiary. So that would be the outcome. And this is consistent with Salant et al, because Salant et al talks about that in complete information model, that was a complete information model, and their duopoly to monopoly is always a profitable merger. That is following in this particular situation also. Now the problem is the private information. Now private information creates the following problem in the following way, that your J is not known. So if you remember the way smartly we are actually calculating this PJ was based on the idea that we know J, okay? And we also know lambda, that is the duopoly to monopoly profit. So if we know J, we'll be able to find out lambda J, and then based on any alpha, we'll be able to get our PJ. But now if we do not know J, then any price that you pay, any positive price that you pay, you might be under some kind of uncertainty that you are actually paying too high price for the shares, whereas the actual share price will be low. So now imagine that J can take two values, high value X and low value Y, okay? So that is our next order of business. So in the high state of demand, J can take value X, and in low state of demand, the J can take value Y. Okay, so now if you buy any shares, what is your main apprehension? Your main apprehension that you should not pay too much to the host firm, because paying that means that you might get with some probability that market is low and you have unnecessarily paid high. Okay, so this creates an adverse selection problem, that when you buy an asset whose true value is not known to you, then you might end up buying a bad asset, okay? So this is the adverse selection, and Q is the probability that it is the prior probability that it is the high state of demand will be realized, and 1 minus Q is the probability that low state of demand is realized, and Q is common knowledge, okay? But host firm knows for sure what is the true value of J, that is whether it is X or whether it is Y. But it always has the intention of mimicking to be high type, in a sense that look, the market is fantastic. If you come and buy shares at the high price, you will realize that it's a very big market, India, and you will do a good business in future. So market will always be high. That is the kind of pretension that the host firm will always try to convince the foreign firm. Okay, but foreign firm knows that actually there's a Q probability it could be high, one minus q, it is low. Okay, so the host form will always have the intention of mimicking to be high. So that creates a problem of buying out shares from the host firm, because host firm can pretend, despite knowing that it is a low state that will be realized, but it might pretend that it is a high demand. So now, to make our story complete, we need to have credible threat of entry, otherwise our entire story falls flat. So our last third and fourth node, where the entry is being considered by the foreign firm, has to be a viable option. So to make that viable option, it will be viable if entry is feasible even with low demand. And low demand means y. So lambda y minus af greater than 0 means lambda x minus af greater than 0. So entry is always a viable option, whether it is a high demand or a low demand. Okay. Now we will consider two different variants of this model. One is with commitment, another is without commitment. Now, if we are able to make the commitment that after acquisition or merger, the foreign firm will give up its right to enter further, okay, so that's a situation of commitment, that I will never enter, and that commitment can be made, okay. Now, if I cannot commit, that will be my second version, 3.2. So, if I'm able to commit, then I will look at what are the ways I can buy out. Now, there are two types of the host firm. Now, host firm has reservation payoff, so those determines its participation constant. So these two are participation constants of the two types of firm. Okay, participation means that it will accept the offer, provided that he is assured of this much amount of profit. Okay, and host firm knows its own type. And then the designing of the contract has to be such by the foreign firm that it is incentive compatible, which means that if I am offering SXPX and SYPY, the two separate menu of contract, then what is meant for type X should be only accepted by type X, and what is meant for type Y will be only accepted by type Y. Okay, so to ensure that incentive compatibility, these two sets of constants are laid out. These are incentive constant, so the X type will always be getting more payoff by accepting SXPX offer. Y type will be always getting more payoff from accepting SYPY offer. Okay, by mimicking that it is X type, and then if it chooses SX and PX, then its overall payoff will go down, because the true value in the market of the monopoly profit is Y. Okay. Similarly, by mimicking to be low type and accepting the low type's offer, will be bad for the high type. So these incentive constant has to be satisfied if I want to enforce a situation of separating contract. Okay.
Any questions? Any questions so far?
No, sir.
Okay, so this material will be available to you. So I will send it today so that you can read it ahead of time when you come to the next class. Okay. And all of you have filled out the form of presentation, the topic at least. I have not checked. That's why I'm asking. Have you done that?
Yes, sir. I think most of us have filled.